Welcome to Stetson Law Live, an online, interactive, informational event for prospective students of Stetson University College of Law. On today's show, Laura Zuppo, Roberta Flowers. Our topic today, the LLM in Elder Law. Use Ustream's chat feature to have your questions answered in real time. And now, Laura Zuppo and Roberta Flowers.
Hi, thank you so much for joining us. We apologize for the slight delay. We're so glad so many of you could log in. My name is Laura Zuppo. I am the Assistant Dean of Strategic Enrollment Management here at Stetson. With me is Professor Bobbi Flowers. Professor, would you just take a minute maybe to introduce yourself, your background, what you teach, all of that fun stuff, and then we'll dive into the program.
Absolutely.
All right.
Good afternoon. We're glad you could join us. My name is Bobbi Flowers. As Laura indicated, I'm a professor here at Stetson College of Law. I teach in the LLM program, the Elder Law, the Ethics in Elder Law, and I'm also the director of the LLM and the co-director of the Center for Excellence in Elder Law. I came from a criminal background and now do exclusively elder law work. So that's a little bit about me.
How did you find your way to elder law? Was that something you always had a passion for?
You know, it's one of those fluky things in life where you really never see yourself on that side. When I came to Stetson, I was teaching in the criminal area because I was a criminal prosecutor before I came here, and slowly kind of worked my way from criminal law and advocacy into ethics. And then there are so many fascinating things about ethics and elder law just called to me. So I started doing some ethics and elder law stuff and slowly got brought over to elder law. So
well, and it's an important
Absolutely.
Area of law. And today what we really want to do is tell everybody a little bit about our program. And so I think what we'll probably do is we'll start for the first 20 minutes or so with Professor Flowers. We'll tell you a little bit about sort of the structure, logistics of the program. And then we're going to bring in one of our alumni, and she is going to tell you about her experiences. What I would love to have happen is, as everyone is watching and listening out there, let us know where you're living. That way we know you can hear us. Also, as you think of questions, it could be on any part of the LLM, from financial and on, type them in. That way we address them for sure. And we did get your questions in advance, and we'll certainly address those as we go. So, Professor Flowers, first of all, what inspired you to create the LLM in Elder Law, and what really is an LLM? What does it do for people?
Well, I think that Professor Morgan and I began this idea back a lot of years ago. We really thought that there was a need back in 2007 to have an advanced degree in Elder Law. For one reason, a lot of JD programs back in 2007 weren't doing any elder law courses at all. And so people were coming out and they hadn't had any experience in elder law. So we saw that need. We also saw the need for a lot of attorneys that were moving into elder law needing to have some extra education. So an LLM, and our LLM specifically, tries to combine two things. We try to combine the really deep down academics with regard to elder law, so that you're really learning about the basis of elder law, the policies behind elder law, but we also want it to be very practical. And that's why we have most of our adjuncts are practicing lawyers that are very high in the elder law field, very well-known practitioners. And so we like to combine the idea that LLM is an advanced degree, so we want to make sure that we're giving you some very good law, but also some practical things that you can hopefully use the next day in your practice.
Excellent. And so one of the really neat factoids about this program, our folks calculated it here, Darlene Kreisen, 115 people have graduated from this program, and
yes,
we have 9 slated to graduate in May. That's a pretty amazing accomplishment.
Yes. Yeah, we're very proud of our alums, and I'm excited for you to hear from one of them in just a few minutes.
Yeah.
But we have just been so, I just use the word blessed, to have some amazing people from all different backgrounds to decide to come to Stetson and get the LLM.
So let's talk a little bit about the program itself. It's, you know, a lot of people who are out there, and it's really neat to see. We have Travis is from Washington State, Debbie in New York. We have some Florida folks. Great to see all of you. Denver, Colorado, that's exciting. That's Professor Flower's stomping ground when she's not here. You know, we've had people from all over the country participate in this program. And so, you know, it's an online program.
Right.
And I'm sure everybody's aware of that. So let's take a little bit of time to really talk about the program's structure, right? Let's talk about the basics, credit hours, and sort of how long does it take, those things. And then maybe we can talk about the curriculum right after that.
All right. Okay. So the Elder Law LLM requires 25 hours. There's a combination of required courses and electives. You can take one credit or one class. You can take two classes. You can take three classes. Three is the maximum. And I'm going to say right up front, I really encourage first-time students, first-semester students, to not try to take three credits or three classes. It's just way too much for a practicing lawyer. Now, if you happen to be somebody that's not practicing right now, three credits or three classes might make sense. Mm-hmm. But if you're a practicing lawyer, one or two is going to be probably the amount you would want to take to start with. And then if you felt comfortable, you could increase it to three. You're not committed to that. We have some students that graduated that took one class every semester, and they just made their way through it, and they graduated that way. So we're really flexible with regard to how many classes you need to take in any one given semester. as you said, it's all online except for our one weekend class, and so I want to put the weekend class to the side for a second. So it's an online course, and it's asynchronous, which means you don't have to be on at any given time. We have a graduate from Hawaii, we have a graduate from Alaska, and they would be on all kinds of crazy times because you can be online whenever you need to be online. So I would be getting up in the morning, and our Hawaii person would, you know, just be going to bed. So you don't have to be on at a certain time. You have a week to complete all assignments. So in other words, if you're in my ethics course, for example, my ethics course might open on Thursday at 5 o'clock, and you would have from Thursday at 5 o'clock to finish the reading assignments, finish the videos, and to finish the discussion board. And we're gonna talk a little bit more about those different parts at any time during that week. So you don't need to worry about, well, this week I've got this going on or that going on, because you can work around that with your schedule. We do have the one, which we think is just like the best part of the program, actually. We do have one weekend course where we require you to come here to Stetson. It is when we have our Special Needs Trust Conference. Our Special Needs Trust Conference this year is October 17th through the 19th. And you attend the Special Needs Conference. And Special Needs Trust is a very growing field, very interesting field that elder law attorneys have begun to go into. This is our 20th year. I always joke that Professor Morgan knew Special Needs Trust was cool before anybody else knew how cool it was. And so you come to the conference for 2 days, for Thursday and Friday, and then on Saturday we do what's called a Select Topics Day, where we pick really the hot topics to talk about. Okay. And you come here to campus, we help you get your computers all set up, we get all of your administrative stuff done. Professor Morgan and I are willing to meet with you to kind of help you with your schedules, and then we have some special topics that are discussed on that Saturday. We love that weekend because we get to finally meet you guys in person, as opposed to just your picture. You get to watch us a lot, but we don't get to see you. So it's always fun to kind of introduce you to each other and introduce you to all of our alums, because we usually have a reception that weekend, and we get to know you a little bit better. So it's a great weekend. But almost everything's online except for that one weekend.
Well, and we actually have a question about how long is the program? I think it's about 2 years. Most people do it in about two, but they can take up to five or six?
Six.
Okay, so folks, for those of you who are worried about, you know, I don't think I can do two classes a semester, we have had people go up to as long as 6 years. That's our policy, right? Okay.
Yeah, it has to be completed within 6 years, and it can be completed in as little as a year and a half.
Okay. So we also have this BKR. Thank you for these questions. Where can we find the curriculum? Darlene, I don't know if you happen to have the Elder Law page handy online where we could link to it. Okay, so Darlene's going to pull it up and post it. And if you want, you can copy and paste it. Don't forget, everybody, we're going to email you this webinar link when we're done, probably usually the next day. Stan has a pretty quick turnaround time. But we'll send this to you so you can check back. But the curriculum is on our website. highlight, but I do know we happen to have a copy in our cheat sheet here. So, Professor, do you want to just highlight some of the
sure.
cool courses that we offer?
Right. So let me talk first about the required courses. We have what's called Aging in the Law, that's taught by Professor Morgan, a very multidisciplinary course, very much about aging, all kinds of issues that people who are aging face, and then how the law impacts that. We have long-term care planning that is taught by Mary Alice Jackson, who is former president of the elder law section here in Florida. She's now in Austin, Texas. We have estate and gift tax planning by Dennis Sandoval. I teach the ethics and the practice of law course. We have guardianship and alternatives, which is taught by a former president of NALA, Ed Boyer. Retirement planning, very, very famous practitioner, Robert Fleming from Arizona. And select topics, that's what I talked about earlier, which Professor Morgan teaches. So those are the required courses. We then have a set of electives, disability law, usually taught in the summer, government and private health, representing the elderly, which is kind of a litigation course, which is kind of interesting. A lot of people say, oh, I would never want to do litigation, but we have a course that talks about what kind of litigation goes on in an elder law practice. Law, aging, and mental health is sometimes offered. We kind of offer disability some summers and mental health some summers, just depending on what the people want. We have a great veterans benefits course that we love. And then we have our intro course, which is for students that, say, have done no elder law at all. So let's say that you just got out of your JD program and you only had a couple of classes in elder law, but you haven't really practiced elder law. Then we would ask you to take as an elective the intro course in your first semester, which is a great way to get kind of the broad view of the entire area of elder law before you then dive into some of the specific courses. So that's our curriculum. I know that I went on forever and ever, but you can look it up online also. So
no, but it's very helpful because I think a lot of folks want to know, they have questions, right? And actually, John, you have a good question. Elder law and estate planning law differences and similarities.
Absolutely. That's
All
a
right.
great question.
It is good.
That's a great
I like
question.
It.
Well, so, different people describe the distinction differently. The way I describe it is this. Most estate planning people are looking at what happens to your estate after you die. Elder law attorneys are very interested in your life before you die, right? Figuring out how to make your life better while you're still here on earth. You know, how do you get benefits? Do you need help with housing? Do you need long-term care? Do you need a guardianship? All the things that are needed before you die. So that's kind of the way I look at it. Obviously, elder law attorneys do a lot of estate planning. Estate planners do not do as much in the elder law realm. Estate planners are usually not going to be working with public benefits. They're not going to be working with veterans benefits. They're going to be much more about the planning and the documents for once you die. They may do some end-of-life documents, but they're not going to do a lot of the elder law stuff. Now, I have another friend who actually graduated from our program, Amos Goodall up in Pennsylvania. He says that elder law is holistic estate planning. That's mm-hmm. how he describes it,
way.
Right? Because you're looking at the whole person as opposed to just their estate. Mm-hmm. So that's how he describes the difference. People will differ on whether those are good definitional differences, but that's kind of broadly what the difference is. A lot of the estate planners are just not going to get involved in a lot of the family dynamics, a lot less than elder law attorneys are. And so elder law is a real holistic kind of practice.
That's helpful. What I was thinking about as you were talking is, are you familiar with the Suffolk program or any of the other LLM elder law or other similar programs?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, what really makes the Stetson LLM different or unique than some of the other programs that are available in the market?
Right. All right. Well, we are, I think this is still true, we are the only one that is totally online. So that's very helpful. That's why we are able to really get practitioners from across the country, which is
right.
so interesting because most of the education in our LLM program comes from the discussion board, right? Which is kind of our virtual classroom where everybody's talking to each other and they're learning from each other. And so it's a very exciting for people to learn what do they do in New York and what do they do in Washington. And so we're completely online. I also think, and this is not due to me at all, it's all Professor Morgan. Professor Morgan knows everybody and people wear t-shirts that say you cannot say no to Professor Morgan.
I have that t-shirt.
Yes, we all have that t-shirt,
I think I have
right?
It at home. Yeah.
Because she can call up any practitioner and basically say, hey, would you come teach a class for me? So we, I believe, have some of the top practitioners
Excellent.
Teaching in our course because we have a lot of former NALA presidents, people that are on the board of directors for NALA, which is, NALA is the National Academy of Elder Law Attorneys, I'm sorry. And so we're really proud of that. So we have former people that used to be presidents are now teaching. And we're also very proud of the fact that our LLMs become leaders across the nation. At one point, the president of NALA and the president of NELF were both LLM graduates. So that was pretty exciting. The current president of NELF, which is the National Elder Law Foundation, is one of our LLM grads. So we really feel like that we are producing some of the leaders of tomorrow
right.
in the elder law area, and that's very exciting.
Well, speaking of leaders, I think this is a great segue for us to show you just a brief video from one of our alumni, and then also bring in a current alum who's hanging out in the wings here. And then we're going to probably talk a little bit more about sort of the program, and then I do want to circle to sort of the cost and application aspects of the program. So Stan, you want to go ahead and roll that, and then we'll come back in a few seconds?
I'm in a small practice in southeastern North Carolina, and I attended Stetson's LLM program in elder law on a part-time basis, working and raising my family, to retool myself as an elder law attorney. And I stand before you today, a Stetson LLM graduate, to tell you that this program has transformed me as a practitioner and will forever change the way I view and practice elder law. This program will be an investment in time and in yourself, a worthwhile one. The future practice of elder law is going to take a different breed of lawyer. The successful elder law attorney will be the one who possesses the skill set to holistically evaluate, assess, and integrate a client's circumstances into a proper course of action. And at Stetson, you learn from the best. Stetson's faculty is comprised of powerhouse practitioners, scholars, and experts in their own right. They so graciously share the gems they've amassed over years of practice. And so it can be done. Work, family, and the pursuit of excellence in elder law.
Able to get Debra Dandar on here, so I think Stan's got the widescreen. Do you want to go ahead and introduce yourself, tell us a little bit about your background, where you're from, and how you found out about the LLM?
Well, I went to Stetson for my JD, and I was practicing here locally. One of the professors here at Stetson had recommended that if I was going to be a good estate planner, I might want to get into doing some probate litigation and find out the bad things that happened so I didn't make those
okay.
mistakes myself. In doing that, I really, my heart was broken many times when I saw some of the things that had taken place, some of the people who had been exploited and isolated as a part of that exploitation. And I didn't like the fact that they were dead and they were gone and there was nothing I could do to help them. And I really wanted to be on the other side and helping them while they were still alive, see how I could make a difference in their life. And then one day, I just happened to find out that Stetson was offering this LLM in elder law, and I just immediately said, that's it. That's what I'm supposed to do. And then I got into the program.
When we were talking beforehand, I just wanted to get, we were working on a blog, so we have a lot of quotes from Debra on this. You had talked about one of the courses, the veterans course specifically, mm-hmm. and you called it phenomenal. So do you just give us a little understanding of why that particular course was so helpful at the time and now in your practice?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because it was actually taught by one of the judges on the appellate court from the Veterans Court of Appeals. And, you know, I learned so much just about the court system itself and how unique that was. But the book that we used was absolutely great, and it had all the sections. It was just a manual on how to practice in the area of veterans law. But having an actual judge teaching the course and telling us everything that we needed to know was wonderful.
Wow. That's pretty neat. I see, Thomas, you have a good question up there. Do any courses deal specifically with drafting trusts, particular special needs trusts? So maybe between the two of you, we could answer Thomas's question.
A lot. Well, obviously, our special needs trust conference is specifically about special needs trusts, and so there's a lot of very good information about drafting special needs trusts, what administration of special needs trusts involves. Professor Morgan always brings in some very interesting people from the government side that will talk about what you need to have in that special needs trust and how you can, in fact, mess up a special needs trust. So that's a very helpful class. Our disability class also talks about special needs trusts. Our disability class is a very practical class that's talking about how to deal with people with disabilities, not kind of the constitutional issues or even the ADA issues, but really the issues of how does a practitioner help somebody that has a disability. So both of those classes have special needs trust information in them. Obviously, Mary Alice Jackson's class with regard to long-term care planning is going to have some special needs trust drafting and some drafting of other kinds of trusts. So several of our classes are going to deal with drafting of trusts.
Interesting. And BKR, thank you for posting the course description. That's pretty great of you. I love that.
Yeah.
Good. Great audience participation. So keep the good questions coming. What I want to talk to you guys about next is sort of, Professor Flowers talked about the structure of the program, that it was asynchronous and you can do it at any time. In reality, how hard was it to balance work, life, family, school, and your own business? I mean, tell us about that.
Ask her how many kids she has.
And how many kids do you have, if you don't mind sharing?
I have five.
Okay.
And I now have two grandchildren.
Wow, we were very busy at the time.
Yeah.
So how'd you do it?
Well, it was just great. I hate to keep using the word wonderful, but it really was, because I could do it on my own schedule. You know, I could say I'm going to allot a certain amount of time each day when I can do these certain things. And that way I could work around my family, work around my business, and just know that at some point during that next week I needed to accomplish such and such a thing. So,
about how many hours a week do you think you put in?
Oh, goodness. Oh, gosh. It's been since 2009, so it's kind of hard to say. I'd really hate to make a guess at it, to be honest with you.
What do you think your students now are saying on average?
It's kind of like labor. Like, after you do it, you forget about
it. Okay.
Because you wouldn't take the next semester if you didn't.
Right.
We estimate about 6 hours a week per class.
Okay.
But that includes both the lectures, the reading assignments, and the involvement in the discussion board. So we usually estimate about 6 hours a week. And we really try to encourage people to do just what Debra did, which was to try to schedule a time that is your school time every week. Maybe it's after the kids go to bed. Maybe it's in the morning before the kids get up. But some time where you say, okay, Tuesdays from 9 to 12, and Thursdays 9 to 12, that's my school time, right? So to really schedule it in very specifically.
I've talked with several of our students over time because I, you know, doing the financial aid side of things. A lot of them say, you know, instead of skipping that lunch, they take their lunch at work and dedicate an hour on their at work a day, and that's 5 hours a week, and they're reading and watching videos and taking notes, and they get 5 hours in just by actually taking a lunch and dedicating time. That, you know, you mentioned something about the posting in the discussion boards. Debra, when we spoke, you actually told me something about a good discussions in Medicare and learning about Part D. I mean, sounds like it's a really practical discussion. And you mentioned about learning from your peers just as much as professors. Do you think you could just tell folks a little bit about who was in your class with you, things like that?
Yeah, well, Amos Goodall was in my class. Frank Johns, who is, you know, an amazing person, and Nayla was in my class. And listening to people with so much experience, I wasn't doing guardianship at the time, and listening to everybody say, here's how I handle this in a guardianship. It was, I remember stories about, like, like reverse mortgages, good sides, the bad sides, and how it could apply to one person, for example, who had glaucoma. And at the end of life, they lived in a penthouse and a condo, and all they could see was the sunset at night, and it allowed them to stay in their home. Now, you know, most people would have bashed reverse mortgages. This was a great chance to learn from other people about how it applied to their own lives.
Yeah.
I got all kinds of hints and all kinds of tips, and, you know, reading everyone's postings and just having people from all over the United States was wonderful.
Yeah. One of the things that we like to do is have people post things from their practice. So occasionally somebody will post an engagement letter, so
wow.
You can go, oh, that'll work. I could use that. Or if you're doing a retainer agreement or consent orders. So a lot of that practical stuff that the students really learn from each other,
right.
Which I just think is so fun to watch as a professor, because you see them interacting with each other and you're just kind of going, yay.
Well, and I think that's the fear for some people, is that an online program really isn't interactive, or they won't get to know their classmates or professors. But everything I've heard now and in many years before, it's not like that. You really do get to know people. And so how do you get to know each other? Is really the postings and then also the conference, really,
right?
Mm-hmm. Sounds like there's a lot of interaction.
Yeah.
That's good.
And sometimes they get really chatty. Like, it's very funny, because sometimes, you know, you only have to post four times a week, but people get talking to each other and they'll end up posting, you know, 11, 12, 13 times. So, and they'll start asking questions about each other, and we try to introduce each other at the very beginning so everybody can kind of get a feel for where you're from and what kind of law you've done in the past and what you're doing now. So people just really start to bond even online. So it's cool.
Well, and for those of you who are watching, how many of you have actually done an online class before? I'd love to get a quick poll of the folks watching, because I think that folks who did online or distance ed maybe 10 years ago, 15 years ago, it's not the same as this program. I mean, this is rigorous. Sometimes I hear folks say they put more time into these online courses than they might otherwise, because you need to, right? I mean, you have to be disciplined and you're watching videos. Would you say it's a fairly rig? Of course, Professor Flowers is going to say this, but Debra, would you say it's pretty rigorous and equal to your experiences in a brick and mortar environment?
Sure, absolutely. Okay. I work just as hard.
Yeah.
Yeah,
that's important.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think the reason sometimes that you end up feeling like you put more time in than you would have in a brick and mortar, you can hide out. Right? Like in my class, you can hide out. Like I'm not going to call on you every week, probably. I may call on you once or twice a semester. But if you're having to every week discuss what we've talked about in the lectures and discuss what's going on in the readings, then you're forced to really engage with the materials every week. You can't wait till the 13th week and then say, okay, I'll read everything now.
Mm-hmm. Now, one thing that I know, and I'm asking this question because I happen to know that I know, sometimes we have students who will say, I'm afraid to do this now because certain times of the year I might be going to trial, or I might have something crazy come up. How do you work with your students when they have something come up and maybe can't fully engage that 1 week? What do you let them do? Oh, I see there's a story there.
Oh, yeah,
okay, let's hear it.
Yeah, I actually had two. One was that my mother, you know, passed away, and they were very accommodating for me during that period. And then also I suffered a back injury, and I had to go through some surgical procedures, and they were very kind and gave me extensions to get things done, and I just really appreciated it. And in the midst of that, I had a daughter getting married, and so a lot of things were going on, but they were very accommodating, very kind to me, so I appreciated that.
Well, and I see that Debbie and Travis have posted about teaching online or not doing an online class, so I'm hopeful that this has been helpful for you as we've talked about the online. But John, you have a question about, does elder law intersect with probate law? Let's take that one.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. I do a lot of that. And what I try to do is actually try to help them avoid probate if we can, because when we're doing Medicaid planning, for example, the last thing we want to do is end up opening a probate estate.
Right.
Because then Medicaid recovers from that. So we always try to help them to structure their assets in such a way to avoid probate. But sometimes probate happens, you know, and then we handle that as well.
Yeah. Probate is one of those kind of unique areas that not a lot of elder law attorneys do. They may do probate administration, but they probably don't do probate litigation. So usually they're administrating a probate or administrating an estate, and that's something you do a lot of, right?
Correct. Yeah, I do a lot of probate administration. I stay very far away from litigation.
Yes. And again, I mean, one of the differences between elder law is that we're trying to avoid those issues. One of the things that I'm very proud of with regard to NALA is that we're always talking about family harmony. How do we do things to keep the family from fighting after mom or dad is dead, right?
Absolutely.
And we spend a lot of time talking about that because that issue is important to our clients. Mm-hmm. And we have to figure out ways that we can help them accomplish that.
Mm-hmm. So. Looks like Murphy posted a great question. Can you cherry pick areas of elder law to practice?
Oh, absolutely. Mm-hmm. I don't think you're doing guardianships now, are you?
They keep coming in.
Yeah.
I keep trying to say no, but yeah. It just, you know, when you've been working with somebody, a family, it's very hard to turn them down and say, we aren't going to do guardianships anymore. But I used to do, for example, Social Security disability. I did that. And I also, on the veterans benefit side of it, I did the service connected, trying to get their compensation claims. I actually weeded those two things out of my practice. Mm-hmm. And the only veterans benefits I do now, for example, is I focus on aid in attendance to try to get them assistance in their homes.
Okay.
So, yeah. Right. So as time goes by, you kind of weed out the things you don't like as much.
Yeah. Yeah. And a lot of lawyers specialize in certain areas of elder law. They don't do the broad base. But I will tell you, if you become interested in getting a CELA, which is the Certified Elder Law
Designation.
I was looking for a word. Thank you.
Sure.
Though all of those topics would be on there, so you wouldn't be able to cherry pick those topics. You'd end up doing a broad base of topics.
So for different, we're going to have people watching who are different levels of experience, right? So for somebody who might be watching right now who's new to elder law, can you explain the difference for the designation and the degree, why you might pursue one over the other? So we've had that come up before.
Yeah. Well, this is an academic achievement. It is something that says, just like all college and all advanced degrees, that you were willing to get that advanced degree, which is different than a CELA. A CELA is a designation. You take an exam to get that designation. And there's not the same, I don't want to say this because I write the exam for the CELA exam, but there's not the same education to get a CELA that there is in elder law, LLM. An LLM is really about educating you to be a leader, not just a practitioner, but to be a leader in the area of elder law, and to be a policy thinker, and to, you know, not just get great practical skills, which I think we give, but also to be really thinking of elder law in a more broad, which is not going to be part of a CELA designation.
Thank you. We have two other questions that popped in. I want to take the first one from Debbie. Thank you, Debbie. Are state-specific differences in elder law discussed? And after we take these two, I want to talk a little bit about admissions and aid also.
Okay. So, yes. Most of our classes are going to require you at some time to say, okay, here's what we talked about broadly. Tell us what your state does. So we're going to ask you to research a specific topic for your state, because we want you to know what those issues are. In elder law, we use the model rules, but I'll occasionally say, okay, I want you to take your model rules. I want you to take the case law from your state and tell me how this fact pattern would come out differently in your state than it would in a model rule state.
Okay.
So we try to encourage students to be looking at their state-specific rules in the classes.
Well, and the next question, I guess we could really have both of you address. Will the LLM help me begin a sole practice right away? Murphy tells us a little bit about background, 3 to 5 years of experience trying to get into an existing firm. So, sole practice, what do you think?
It did for me.
It did for Debra. All right.
Yeah, and we've had several, actually, of our LLMs that went straight from getting their LLM to running a solo practice. So that's something that we see happen.
I will say I have a thriving practice in Tampa, and you know, I would say I am at a point now where, and you know, I got my LLM in 2009, and I am probably running at least 50% referrals now, and I get 50% from the internet, largely. But it's just been a wonderful practice for us. You know, we've done great.
So, And Murphy, you had a question about who you can speak with at Stetson. You can definitely email the Elder Law Center. Darlene's actually in the process of giving you her phone number and I'm sure an email as well. Just give a call. Everyone's willing to talk with you about the program. And speaking of the program, the application is now open.
Yay!
It's time to apply. We have the application open. There's no application fee. It is on our website. It's a one of those fillable PDFs. If you want to print it and write in, it's fine. It's not going to be very time intensive, but we do ask you to take the essay portion seriously. You will need transcripts. You do not have to have an additional standardized test. That is, you don't have to do that anymore, fortunately. Do you want to tell the folks a little bit about what you're looking for in sort of the, I hate to use this word because it drives me crazy on the JD side, but the ideal candidate,
right?
And maybe what they should be doing in their essay.
Okay. I will tell you one of the most important parts of the admission process for us is the personal statement. We're really looking for people that are doing this because they have a passion for elder law and a passion for this very vulnerable population. And so when you're writing that personal statement, we want to understand why it is you're doing this. Like, you know, it's okay if people want to just take an LLM just to get some LLM, but we're really looking for students that have a desire to really serve a group of people, and we believe that this LLM will help them serve them better. So we really look at those personal statements. Grades are important, but obviously if those grades were 10 years ago, they're not going to be as important as what you've been doing in the last 10 years. But grades are important. I'm not going to say they're not, but I would say that they're probably not as important as they were at the JD level. Right. And as you said, we don't have any tests. We also read the recommendations. I'm always interested in what kind of recommendations people have. But that personal statement is where you really want to spend your time, because that's something that I'm really going to look at and consider for our next class.
And also a resume. And for those of you who haven't done a resume in a little while, it's time to dust it off and go ahead and update it. You will need to submit a resume with your materials. Transcripts, you can have them sent via paper to us, electronic. We accept them in all forms. So if you have questions about all of that, Darlene is posting, and it's being persnickety here, but it's, it looks like trying to post the email address, but why don't we do this? It is Elder Law, is it, want to tell it to me?
Elder Law.
Elder Law.
One word.
At one word. Elder Law, one word, at
law.stetson.edu.
All right, I'll say it one more time. Elder Law at law.stetson.edu. And if you just give a call to 727-562-7800, the team of our fantastic operators will get you over to Elder Law.
And they're another great thing is once you've contacted Darlene, she is more than happy to send out a list of alums that would be more than happy to talk to you about Elder Law. I say this a lot, and I really truly believe it. Elder Law attorneys are the most satisfied lawyers I've ever dealt with in my life. They love their jobs. They love what they do. They feel so much like they help people. And so it's the kind of practice where you go home at night and you say, I did something right today. Mm-hmm. And I had the opportunity to spend some time with a lot of other kinds of practitioners, and they're all great folks, but not nearly as kind of satisfied, for want of a better word, than I find elder law attorneys to be. Okay. Like, Debra's a great example of that, that, you know, she just loves what she does.
You know, it's nice. I get hugs, I get candy, I get sometimes a bottle of wine.
I love that.
But they really appreciate what I do for
that
them.
That's true. So we have, obviously, the application, and it's a very, very quick process. You get that in, and then we start in the fall. And there's a brief orientation to help people get acclimated to the technology and the expectations. So you're not in this alone. Professors Flowers and Morgan, they're really, really good at helping people with this transition. Because, face it, if you've been out of school for a while, it's a little scary, it's a little daunting to think about going back. But it's doable, and we've had, obviously, 115 plus successful folks complete it. Most of the people who start the program do ultimately graduate.
Right. We also have a great IT department.
Great IT.
I am telling you, our IT department are on call. I'll get up in the morning, and they will have been helping some student at 2 o'clock in the morning. I don't know when these people sleep. And so we have a really good support system. So for people that maybe are a little bit concerned about technology, Julie Kitzmiller, if she ever retires, we'll all have to retire, is just constantly helping students to be able to get through the technology stuff. So we have a great support system.
So we started a little bit late, so I'm hoping we can just run just a few more minutes, because several of you had questions about the finances. And so here are the quick numbers. So the per credit hour tuition is $1,400. And there are student loans that you can take if you wanted to take student loans. If you are a veteran or an eligible dependent, you can certainly use veterans benefits for this program. You would contact our financial aid office for loan and VA related questions. Just FinAid, FinAid, finaid@law.stetson.edu. Or if you call the Elder Law Center, Darlene will just transfer you over to us, Jennifer, Heidi, or even me, and we'll help you out. Some of our students do choose to pay as they go, and they might use credit card or pay directly. Others have employer benefits, and we are certainly able to receive employer benefits directly. I believe one of our folks wrote in ahead of time that they do have an employer benefit, and can we accept that? We are happy to take your money any way you would like to give it to us. it's really, really good in terms of how we work with you. The Elder Law program also has scholarship opportunities, which is fantastic. So maybe let them know how they apply for scholarship.
Right. Once you have been admitted to the program and have paid your deposit, then you can request a scholarship. A committee looks at your application for the scholarship. We look at both merit and need. So we want to look at what you've told us about that. The application process is easy. You basically just write an email and send it in to us requesting a scholarship. We give scholarships $1,400 for each class you take. So basically, if you were to receive a scholarship, you would literally have one third of the expense cut off the top. Once you get the scholarship, you have to reapply every year, but I will tell you, or every semester, but I will tell you that if your grades, you maintain your grades, it's going to be a given that you're going to continue to get scholarships. So that's a great way to lessen that amount as you go forward. And Stetson's been very generous with us to give scholarships to our Elder Law LLMs.
And I will say that just from the financial aid hat that I wear when I'm not on the JD admissions side, the Elder Law LLM students have frequently told me that the return on investment's there for this program. That, you know, that there might be skepticism going in, but do you want to just kind of tell us just a little bit about your thoughts on that? We have
sure.
not prepped her on this question.
Okay, no, sure. I find that I get a lot of referrals. People, when they want to research and find out who am I going to hire, they go and they look for what separates me from all the other elder law attorneys out there. And when they see that LLM designation, even if it's a person who doesn't understand, very often the families are being referred by other attorneys to contact me, and they say, oh, she's got an LLM, give her a call.
Yeah, I think that's really important mm-hmm. to hear. Yeah. So any other tips or pointers or words of wisdom before we wrap up for the day? Anything you'd want to share with folks considering
yeah.
this?
I think the one thing I want to say is if you have questions, if you have concerns, please don't hesitate to email myself. You can get me at flowers@law.stetson.edu, or if you send it to the Elder Law one, I will get that also. More than happy to answer questions for you. We believe that we have a very unique program, a program that uniquely situates you for practicing elder law. You know, we have people, as Debra pointed out, in her class, there were two people that had been practicing elder law for 20 years, and they came back and just enjoyed the exercise of digging down deep into the elder law area. So questions, please don't hesitate to ask us. We would love to answer them for you.
That sounds good. Same thing for financial aid. You're welcome to just get in touch with us. And thank you both very, very much.
Pleasure.
Thank you all for spending time with us, and we look forward to hearing from you. Have a good day.
Bye-bye. Bye now.
Thank you for watching Stetson Law Live. For more information, send us an email or give us a call. For your convenience, our contact information will remain on screen for the next few minutes. Be sure to check our homepage often for news, information, and updates. Thanks again. We look forward to hearing from you soon.